When you complete a crossword puzzle, you might get a swell of pride. If you play the Virginia Lottery's $300,000 Crossword Inferno Scratcher, you could win up to $300,000. This $10 scratcher has three puzzles on each ticket, so it's loaded with crossword fun. Visit a lottery retailer near you. For odds and more information, visit valottery.com.
This is a CBC podcast.
Hello, I'm Peter Armstrong. This is day six.
Omicron variant is now the dominant COVID-19 variant.
And the federal modeling suggests we could see some pretty high daily case counts.
We could see cases go up to 10,000 a day.
This is escalating very steeply, still exponentially.
How COVID modeling measures up in the face of Omicron. That's coming up on day six. Today, your must-have Christmas reading list.
It's a really fun read and a different kind of a crime novel.
Our books columnist on what to read and what to wrap. A soundtrack as eclectic as the year.
And I would listen again and again and again.
The Day 6 music panel delivers the best of 2021. And Hallmark Christmas opens up to LGBTQ characters.
Christmas movies where people just fall in love.
All today on Day 6, the Don We Now Are Gay Apparel edition.
Modeling shows that cases will likely dramatically increase very soon. We, like other strong modeling teams from around the world, believe that it is best to treat the Omicron variant as if it were as serious as the Delta variant.
That is not what anyone wants to hear, especially not a week before Christmas. But according to Ontario Science Table, that's where we are. At this point, Omicron is thought to be responsible for somewhere between 30 and 50% of all the COVID cases in Ontario. And according to Canada's top doctor, it's almost certainly not just Ontario.
So what we're seeing in Ontario, I expect to be seen in other areas of the country, as has been seen in Europe and other areas of the world.
Cases spiked across the country this week, leaving an awful lot of uncertainty about what we're in for between now and New Year's Day. The good news is that data scientists have come a long way in learning how to model where the pandemic is headed when they have enough data to work with. Elizabeth Landau is a science writer and contributor to the Smithsonian Magazine. She's been speaking with data scientists about COVID modeling and what they've learned since March of 2020. Elizabeth, good morning. Welcome to Day 6.
Hi, it's so great to be here. Thanks so much.
You've written that, quote, the COVID-19 pandemic sparked a new era of disease modeling. What do you mean by that?
So for my piece in Smithsonian, I got to talk with some of the leading experts in disease modeling. There are so many amazing things happening on the back end that are kind of invisible to most of us, but people who are dedicating themselves to tracking all of these different variables concerning COVID in a way that we've never done with any disease ever in the past. You know, everything that has to do with COVID is not only about the virus itself, it's also about how we behave in response to the virus. In order to model its spread, we have to think about what are people doing in response to the virus? Are they masking up? Are they vaccinated? Does it matter if they are an older person or a younger person? How many people might be immunocompromised? There are so many moving parts to this COVID situation. So in order to capture all that information, models have had to become a lot more sophisticated, take a lot more variables into account, and change on the fly as we receive new information. Now, nobody invented new math to do this kind of modeling, but they have been really pushing the limits of modeling. So it is a great time in terms of people being able to factor a lot of different situations into models.
You know, I write about the economy for CBC News as kind of my day job. And, you know, there was this very weird, conflicting sense in me of almost excitement of seeing people start to obsess over charts and graphs and data in and what's coming in and what's going out over the course of the pandemic. And I wonder, when we talk about modeling, what does that actually mean? What goes in for the modeling to get what comes out?
At the heart of a lot of these models are differential equations. That might sound a little scary, but basically these are equations that are trying to capture a changing situation. So all of the things that relate to COVID, such as people's age, people's vulnerability, people's proximity to other people, likelihood of wearing a mask. You need equations to sort of capture all of these different things. And then, you know, the model has to not only capture the present, but then look forward in time. And of course, the farther out in time a model would look, the less likely it is to be correct, because things are changing all the time.
And what have the scientists that you've spoken with told you about how COVID-19 and the pandemic have changed the way that they understand and the way that they do modeling?
First of all, the fact that everybody knows what an epidemiologist is extraordinary. The word just falls off the tongue now. But in the past, you know, we were just kind of going about our lives. There was just not awareness of the fact that transmitting a virus could be very detrimental to other people's health. But the other thing is that, yeah, like you see these charts and graphs all over the major news media every day. And the general public now has this awareness of, wow, like there are people who are kind of keeping track of, you know, how many people are dying, how many people are being hospitalized, how, you know, likely are they to catch it in their own communities. You know, these are moving targets, but, you know, at least we have some idea of how things have unfolded.
In the magazine article you talked about earlier, you wrote about one biologist in particular, Lauren Ansel Myers at the University of Texas at Austin, and what she kind of went through early on in the pandemic. What did her story show you about modeling it at that early stage of the outbreak?
Yeah, it was really cool to talk to Dr. Myers about her work in trying to understand COVID at a time when we knew almost nothing about it, but we did know that it was going to be very bad in March of 2020. And what was really interesting was that her group at the University of Texas at Austin actually partnered with the city of Austin in coming up with COVID protocols that could be adapted over time as the virus situation became more or less dangerous. That was not the case in many parts of North America. And in fact, at the state level in Texas, there was some tension with the city of Austin because Dr. Myers' group was showing that construction workers would be at higher risk of COVID because of their close proximity to one another in their work, in their in-person work. However, the state of Texas wanted to not limit construction work because they wanted to keep the economy open. You know, you have all of these different pressures that are guiding the public health guidance on the local level versus the state level. So it became a very complicated situation.
As we get longer into the pandemic, I think people are more exhausted at the notion of restrictions and more mandates and more resistant to doing what public health officials have said. So how do you reconcile that in terms of figuring out what people are going to do while you're trying to build a model that will help them make those decisions?
Yeah, it's really difficult. And I've seen recently some of the leading modeling groups, they basically have projections for, okay, this is the situation if nobody wears a mask. This is the situation if everybody wears a mask. This is the situation of this number of people is vaccinated versus a lower number. So now that we know that there are these variables that can change depending on how people behave, with the Omicron variant in particular, you know, again, it's evolving so rapidly. There's so much unknown about how it's going to affect people who are vaccinated versus unvaccinated, but it is pretty clear that if you are vaccinated, you would be more likely to get a milder case of it. So these are just some of the things that are coming about in the models.
Well, listen, I find this stuff fascinating. We really appreciate getting a glimpse behind the curtain of how these models are built and created. So thank you so much for speaking with us this morning.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me.
Elizabeth Landau is a freelance science writer and a contributor to the Smithsonian Magazine. She's also the co-host of the podcast Pod, Paper, Scissors, a show about game theory and decision making.
Oh, Merry Christmas, everyone. Merry Christmas.
That's right. The one,
and only Santa Claus. Going to see Santa's a staple for a lot of families around the holidays. Getting those pictures, the kids sitting with them, the tears, the screams, the pleas for gifts, and all. But last year, seeing Santa was one of the many, many things that couldn't happen as usual.
How did you see Santa last year?
I forget how I saw Santa last year.
We saw Santa over Zoom.
Really?
Yeah, this was Santa here. You met him over Zoom.
That's Mika and her dad, Michael. And Mika, if you blocked out last year, that's totally understandable. Good news, this year, Santa's back in person.
I love seeing Santa.
Of course, things aren't entirely back to where they used to be. Everyone's wearing masks, including Santa. And while the kids could talk to Santa, no one's sitting on his lap. But even with masks and physical distancing, people were pretty happy to see Santa once again. So, Day 6 producer Rachel Levy-McLaughlin went down to the Eaton Centre in Toronto to catch some of the excitement.
Hello, welcome to the North Pole. Are you excited for your Santa visit?
Hi guys, can I get your names? I'm Nilu.
Mila.
Okay, so what was it like seeing Santa today?
Pretty good.
Pretty good?
Yeah.
Did Santa give you some tips?
Yep.
What did Santa tell you? He said, listen to mommy and daddy. What do you like about Santa?
Because he brings presents.
It's really exciting, especially for my son, because it was his first time. So he had the concept, he had the idea, and the whole time we were waiting, he's just like, Santa, 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 Santa. I don't know, my older daughter, if she thinks that we just kind of make him up, he's somebody, another person on a screen. So to see him in real life, I think it's really meaningful for them to get that moment.
So who are we here to see, Mackie?
Santa.
Santa, and are you excited about seeing Santa?
Yes.
Yeah. These little moments mean a lot because it sort of gives you a little reminder of normalcy.
Santa is beckoning us.
We're being paged by Santa.
Okay, hi guys. Say hi.
Hi. My name is Mila and this is Logan.
So are you guys excited to see Santa? How do you feel about seeing Santa today?
We feel happy.
Did you miss Santa last year?
Yeah, I did.
So what do you like about seeing Santa?
Well, I like to see all the other kids coming to see him. And sometimes he'll give out little treats. I saw him out also giving out little presents and candy canes too.
And what are you guys asking Santa for this year?
Squishmallow.
A squishmallow. What's a squishmallow?
It's like a big thing that's squishy and it's like has eyes and melts.
Yes. And what does it mean for you to have Santa back?
Oh, just the joy of Christmas and all the things that we remember about this time of the year, getting together, seeing Santa, having the kids like look forward to something.
Hi, my name is Nikki and this is Izzy. What was it like seeing Santa? Was it fun?
Mm-hmm.
What did you tell Santa?
I wanted a big doll for Christmas and Paw Patrol and Peppa Pig toys.
A guitar?
And Paw Patrol and Peppa Pig toys.
What did Santa tell you? Did he say to leave something out for the reindeer? What are we going to leave out for the reindeer to eat?
Carrots.
I think it's great to bring back the magic of Christmas again this year and to be able to have them sort of fully involved and engaged again. Last year was tough with sort of having to make do with what was available, but it's really great and exciting to be able to plan this kind of stuff again this year.
Hey, thank you so much. Merry Christmas. Happy holidays.
So Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Day 6 producer Rachel Levy-McLaughlin at the Eaton Centre in Toronto. Still lots to come here on Day 6, including our books columnist Becky Toyne is back with her holiday gift guide.
This is that magical time of year when the Hallmark Channel answers the question, how many movies with the word Christmas in the title can we make? The answer is a lot. Have you seen these?
Oh, yes. We've seen them, sometimes more than once. But if you're just discovering Hallmark Christmas movies, here's what you need to know.
Your trees are going to be just fine.
No one else could figure out what was going on. Guess that's why they call you the Christmas Tree Whisperers.
Is there any more romantic time than the holiday?
But if I could make one wish, I'd wish to be here with you.
Some may even say this is a Christmas miracle.
That's about it, actually. Hallmark movies deliver heartwarming stories that revolve around love, family, and Christmas. Also, snow, garlands, small towns, sweaters, and frequently cocoa.
Now, for a long time, Hallmark movies also centered pretty much exclusively on relationships between straight white people. In 2019, the Hallmark Network even pulled an ad showing a same-sex couple getting married after it got complaints from a conservative Christian group. Last year, new CEO Wanya Lucas took over and started moving things in a new direction. And this year, that change seems to be continuing.
I sure hope this Christmas is merry and bright as my three girls come home and at last reunite. I don't have much time, so I think I'll be blunt. I've made one more holiday scavenger hunt.
Every Time a Bell Rings features three adopted sisters reuniting for the first Christmas since their father died. And Canadian actor Ali Liebert, who identifies as queer, plays Nora, who's gay. Oh, and spoiler alert, Nora gets the girl. Ali Liebert says she got a lot of hateful comments on social media after that, but lots of thanks and appreciation too. Ali Liebert has been in many Hallmark Christmas movies, and she joins us now. Ali, welcome to Day 6.
Hey, Peter. Thanks so much for having me.
You tweeted about the amount of sort of homophobic hate that you received since Every Time a Bell Rings was released because your character, Nora, is in a relationship with another woman. Are you surprised to be still getting that kind of response now?
Sadly, I wasn't entirely shocked by some of those responses. But I will say I have been overwhelmed with the love and positive comments as well that I've been receiving from folks all over the world.
I mean, I've seen some of the positive reaction online as well, and it really is heartwarming. What's it like? What does it mean to you to read and to hear and to see how your character in this movie can have such a positive impact on people?
Oh, it's so meaningful. I literally almost started crying. I read one tweet from a mom who said that she and her daughter or her recently newly out tween, and they were, you know, just sitting down to watch a Hallmark Christmas movie like they always do. And they were totally surprised to see this queer storyline. And it meant the world to her daughter. They were crying and screaming in their living room. And that to me is so meaningful as a queer person and someone who's, you know, acted in Hallmark movies for a long time. And then the mom tweeted back to me once I retweeted her tweet that now she's the coolest mom because she told her kid that I retweeted her story. But it's just amazing. It's just amazing.
And I mean, when you were young, we just didn't have as many characters and models that you could look on screen and connect with and say, yeah, that's me. I'm just like her.
No, totally. And I mean, I came out later in life. And I think, you know, the steps that the Hallmark Channel and all, you know, all sorts of other networks are taking to broaden their scope of what the world looks like and represent queer people in all types of stories, not just coming out stories, but Christmas movies where people just fall in love. Who knows? Maybe I would have come out a lot sooner if I had seen one of my stories.
And I mean, one of the things I love about the character of Nora and this kind of storyline is it isn't a coming out story. It's just a Christmas story that has a gay character in it that people can connect to. Why is that, and that sort of reflection of just everyday life, the importance of having a depiction of a queer character so important in your opinion?
It's a story about three sisters who, you know, are coming together and they go on the scavenger hunt, and one of them happens to be queer and the other two happen to be straight. And no one in the movie has a comment on Nora's sexuality. No one has a problem with it. She just is who she is and her family accepts her. They don't even talk about it. So that type of, you know, quote unquote normalcy, I think is really important as well. It doesn't pose being queer as a problem. It's just one of the things that we know about Nora.
Hallmark movies, and maybe I'm making an assumption here, but they seem to be hugely popular in the LGBTQ community, even though they haven't always done so much to represent LGBTQ interests. Why do you think they're so popular in those circles?
Queer or straight people, we're all burnt out by the time it gets to December, and they have themes of hope and love and nothing bad happens and people like unwinding and watching these really sweet stories. So I will share that a lot of the feedback I've been getting from folks online is from queer folks who are like, finally, we love Hallmark movies and now we can see ourselves represented. So I think people just love Christmas movies. I do.
Oh, for sure. And I mean, you've done a lot of advocacy over the years to get more queer characters, to have better and more representation. Has that push gotten easier over the years, or is it still just like the sort of constant knocking on the door and saying, hey, can we think about it this way? Or how has that changed over the years?
My advocacy for representation in the projects I'm a part of has been met with a lot more enthusiasm in the last few years, where, you know, 5-10 years ago, it would not have been. So as a queer performer and writer and director myself, I'm always trying to broaden, you know, the scope of what a character or what a story can be.
You know, you talk about the changes just in the last 5 years. We all remember, you know, Hallmark in 2019, the network succumbed to pressure from conservative Christian groups and pulled an ad that featured these two women getting married. And at the time, you were vocal about how and why that was so unacceptable. The network's now clearly under new leadership. What do you think about the progress that not just the film community, but Hallmark in general has made to get to this point where we are seeing, you know, in your case, two women kissing on screen?
I can't speak exactly to Hallmark's plans and how they've decided to move towards the inclusivity that we are now seeing. I would have to say, you know, just speaking for myself, over the last few years, I have seen an evolution, and I have seen this move towards broadening the world. I am the first to say I was very pleasantly surprised when I received the call to play this role of a lesbian in a Hallmark Christmas movie. So for me, as a queer person, just me, Allie, felt very moved by that. And I am proud of the steps that they are making.
Well, listen, we appreciate you. We appreciate your advocacy on this issue. And man, we appreciate a good flick to curl up to. So thank you for all of this.
Thanks for having me, Peter.
Allie Liebert is a Canadian actor who stars in Every Time a Bell Rings, one of this year's crop of Hallmark Christmas movies. Her first movie as a director for Hallmark is North to Home, and it'll be out on January 9th.
I never get what I really want. I always get a lot of stupid toys or a bicycle or clothes or something like that. What is it you want? Real estate.
You know, when I was a kid, I thought Lucy was being ridiculous wanting real estate for Christmas. But now, man, I think she was really onto something. A girl ahead of her time. But since buying real estate as a gift is out of reach for most of us, we've got a more attainable idea. Books. I mean, the weather is getting colder, the news is dreary. Who doesn't want to curl up and escape with a good book? There are 7 days left to finish your Christmas shopping. And our Day 6 Books columnist, Becky Toyne, is here with her annual list of Christmas reads. Books you can buy as gifts or as a gift to yourself. We're handy like that. Becky, good morning. Welcome back to the show.
Good morning. Nice to be here.
Now, you always have a few surprises for us, and this year, one of the surprises is that you have more nonfiction than fiction on your gift list. The second big surprise is that your first book choice, Vanderbilt, The Rise and Fall of an American Dynasty by Anderson Cooper. What drew you to this book?
Well, who among us doesn't have a guilty pleasure of picking up the trashy celebrity gossip magazines at the checkout at the supermarket? And this is that guilty pleasure in book form. So, I mean, Anderson Cooper is, you know, of CNN fame. If anybody doesn't know, he is the son of the late Gloria Vanderbilt. And I think he's often been asked throughout his career, you know, about his famous Vanderbilt family. And his response to that is usually, I'm not a Vanderbilt, I'm a Cooper. So this is a book about New York high society and celebrity gossip and scandal and family legends and of huge fortunes amassed and then frittered away by subsequent generations of just sort of ostentatious wealth and displays of wealth and fancy parties. And I loved it. It's just so fascinating to read. It sort of starts with the introduction of Cornelius Vanderbilt, the Commodore, as he's known, whose statue stands outside Grand Central Station in Manhattan now. And he came about his nickname, the Commodore, because basically when he was very young, when he was sort of 12 or 13, he borrowed money from his mother. He bought a small boat and essentially put his own father out of business, ferrying goods back and forth from Manhattan to Staten Island. And that's how he started to make all his money. And he just amassed this huge fortune. So I found that this is a nonfiction book that would appeal to anybody who's interested in New York and New York history. Anybody who, like I said, has that guilty pleasure, loves to read the trashy magazines, but wants to kind of really engross yourself in it for a bit longer. Anybody who enjoys the nonfiction of Eric Larson, that kind of really narrative-driven nonfiction. There's a little overlap there as well. Eric Larson wrote a book about the sinking of the Lusitania, which also makes an appearance in right. Vanderbilt. Yeah, yeah. So yeah, I loved it. I loved it.
Okay, so that's Vanderbilt, The Rise and Fall of an American Dynasty by Anderson Cooper. In a complete change of direction, what can you tell us about your second nonfiction pick?
Klondikers doesn't have as much high society fanciness, though it does have a little bit. So Klondikers by Tim Falconer is a very long subtitle here. Dawson City's Stanley Cup Challenge and How a Nation Fell in Love with Hockey. And so the description of the book, it tells you that this is about how in 1905, a hockey team from Dawson City in the Yukon called the Klondikers or the Dawson City Nuggets undertook this epic journey across Canada from Dawson City to Ottawa in the middle of winter. It took them 3.5 weeks to go and challenge Ottawa in the Stanley Cup. And that is indeed part of the story, but it's also really kind of the peg on which Tim Falconer hangs this much larger story about Canadian history. So it sort of tells you about characters, including Lord Stanley and including journalists who were really passionate amateur hockey players who were sort of all integral to the creation of hockey as Canada's game. You know, I can tell you I'm someone who has traveled from Toronto to Dawson City recently in the middle of summer, and it's not fast now. And even in the middle of summer, like, the weather can still delay you for 24 hours. So for these group of men to be doing it in the middle of winter in 1905 is in itself this fascinating story, which I think, you know, at the time then in the papers kind of caught the imagination of the country and of hockey lovers and just sort of became this huge sort of unifying national event. So I think this is a great book for someone who enjoys reading Canadian history, the kind written by someone like Charlotte Gray. It's also a great book for a hockey lover who's interested in something to read alongside this year's celebrity player memoir.
Well, count me down on both of those. Okay, so that's Klondiker's Dawson City Stanley Cup Challenge and How a Nation Fell in Love with Hockey. Your third and final nonfiction choice has more of a, can I call it a moral appeal? The Day the World Stops Shopping by J.B. McKinnon. Is this similar to other J.B. McKinnon books?
It is. So J.B. McKinnon has written a number of nonfiction books that are all including a book called The 100-Mile Diet, in which he and his partner spent a year only eating things that were sourced within 100 miles of where they lived. He wrote a book called The Once and Future World, which is about kind of rewilding nature. So all of his books are sort of about the environment and about sustainability. In The Day the World Stops Shopping, he basically conducts a thought experiment about what would happen if we were able to drastically reduce our consumption. And he talks about how, you know, politically, the will is usually around, we need to continue to consume, but how can we green the energy we produce to help us continue to consume, to keep pushing the economy forward and growing the economy. But really, a really great way to green your energy consumption is to just use a lot less of it. And you could use a lot less of it if you start buying less and you start doing less. And so he starts with this thought experiment of, like, what would happen if the world just sort of consumption dropped by 25%? And he started by sort of traveling around and visiting sort of hunter-gatherer communities in different parts of the world where there is already sort of a more sustainable model of living and consumption. But he says that in the beginning, many people that he approached that he wanted to speak to about this wouldn't speak to him because they found his thought experiment too far-fetched. And then while he was writing the book, what happened? COVID happened. And so overnight, consumption dropped. And so his thought experiment suddenly became closer to a reality. And so what is so excellent about this book is that while he was writing it, the pandemic happened, just makes it even more poignant because he's saying, well, look, it did happen and the world didn't fall apart. And yes, we can kind of take this and move forward with it.
Okay, The Day the World Stopped Shopping by J.B. McKinnon is Becky's final nonfiction pick. Let's move on to fiction. Pretty solid choice here, Colson Whitehead. Why'd you choose his book, Harlem Shuffle?
Well, I wanted to talk about Colson Whitehead because he's awesome. So his most recent two novels before this one, back-to-back Pulitzer Prizes. So he wrote The Underground Railroad and The Nickel Boys. He's a prolific novelist, and he is kind of known for sort of what his thing is that he takes different points in American history and he writes different types of novels about them. So he's written speculative fiction, and he's written a zombie novel, and he's written a book about slavery and a book about a reform school in the Jim Crow South. In Harlem Shuffle, he has taken a story that takes place in Harlem between 1959 and 1964. So it has the backdrop of the civil rights movement and the Harlem race riots. And he's written a crime story. It's a crime story with a difference. There's no detective. But it is the story of Ray Carney, whose father was a bit of a hustler, and he has sort of grown up and is a very honest man. He's very proud to be an honest man. He's a family man. He's married. He has a young child, another one on the way. And he runs a furniture store on Harlem's main street. He has his name above the store. He's very proud of it. But the quote that the book begins with is, Carney was only slightly bent when it came to being crooked. And so the whole novel really is about, like, what is a crime and what is breaking the law and where are the gray areas? So Carney begins as a furniture salesman who then starts to have a lightly used section in the store, and he doesn't ask too many questions about where the lightly used items come from. And then he ends up sort of getting accidentally pulled into a heist by his cousin, who's always been a bit of a bad influence. In some ways, the story reminded me a bit of something like The Wire, where the point was that, like, every level of society, whether it be the drug dealers or the politicians or the media or the police, like, everyone is corrupt in some way. And so you have kind of this vibrant, beautiful picture of all of this kind of crazy jewel thievery and sort of trying to just be a good, honest person. It's a really, really fun read and a different kind of a crime novel.
All right, we're going to end off on my favorite category, the kids' books. What have you got for us this year?
I'm going to talk about a book called Time is a Flower by Julie Morstadt. So I am the parent of a small person, and as any parent of a small person, or not even that small, knows, like, your life becomes very much ruled by time and schedules, like nap time, snack time, lunch time, time to get the school bus, time to go to soccer practice, like, it's time, time, time. And it's probably very frustrating for little kids to be always told, like, hurry up, or we don't have time to do both, or you have to choose one and not the other. But I also feel like, and I think about this a lot, I feel like time is sort of a very rigid adult construct that we kind of force upon ourselves and our children. And it's very difficult for children to kind of get a handle on what time means. Time is a Flower deals with that question so perfectly and so beautifully. And so on the first page, it says time is the tick, tick, tock of a clock. But what else is time? And then on each page, it gives you a beautiful illustration and an example of something that shows that time is always moving forward and always progressing, but that time is what gives us beautiful things and slow things and relaxing things. So time is the slow changes on a face as you grow older. Time is your hair growing from short to long. Time is a pebble that used to be a mountain. It's beautiful. And I think for a child, it helps to understand that time is always moving. And for an adult, I think it's really important to read this and remember that time isn't your enemy and time is a beautiful thing. And I think especially during the pandemic, you know, time has become more blurred, right? Like a lot of those things that used to be our markers, leave the house, go to work, come home from work, like it doesn't happen anymore. It's all a blur if you're working from home. And so this is a really helpful way to remember that time is always moving, but time is your friend and time is beautiful.
Amazing. All right. Time is a Flower by Julie Morstad. This is just, it's a wonderful list, Becky. And man, it sure looks like we're going to have more time at home to get into some of this reading. So I'm glad to have it. So thank you for putting it together. Thank you for this. Be well. Have a great holiday.
Thank you. Happy holidays.
Becky Toyin is our Day 6 Books columnist. You can find a list of all her Christmas read recommendations at cbc.ca/day6. Still lots to come here on Day 6, including the Day 6 music panel is back to share their picks for the best music of 2021.
I told the court that I'm wrong to imprison.
Mr. Sue, you are not to address the jury.
There's too much being hid from you.
You need to be taken out of the court.
There's too much.
He was one small man in a giant wheel caught.
Well, I do wish to say that it's official that I'm wrongfully imprisoned right now.
Uncover, Season 7, Dead Wrong.
I asked him if he killed Pepple. He said yes, and I'd be next.
Available on CBC Listen and wherever you get your podcasts.
I'm Peter Armstrong. You're listening to Day 6 on CBC Radio 1. We're on PRX. You can live stream us on the CBC Listen app, and we're online at cbc.ca/day6. It's been another strange and challenging year. In fact, it still kind of is. But some things did start to return to normal in 2021, like, for example, music. Some live concerts got started again, and there were a ton of new tracks out.
I caught it bad just today. You hit me with a call to your place. Ain't been out in a while anyway. Was hoping I could catch you throwing smiles in my face.
When I'm away from you, I'm happier than ever.
I saw the fire in your eyes. I saw the fire in the look into your eyes. You tell me things you wanna try.
So you know what that means. It's time to convene the Day 6 music panel. Odaria Williams is host of CBC's After Dark and a rapper with Grand Analog. Melissa Vincent's a freelance music writer, editor, and producer. And Andrea Warner is an author and producer at CBC Music. Good morning and welcome back to you all.
Good morning.
Hello.
Hi, it's nice to be here.
I can't wait to get into all of this, mostly because I learned so much from you guys when we do this panel. I want to start with that sort of year-end report you get back from whatever streaming service you use. Mine was a wash in the weirdest stuff. What did yours look like, Andrea?
I actually haven't looked at any of my year-end reports because I go so much across like Spotify, Bandcamp. So my Spotify thing is like, okay, you listen to Little Pimienta 400 times and that's it.
Melissa, where did yours land?
Yeah, I mean, I think I'm in the same boat as Andrea, where Bandcamp is really my streaming darling, but I had a lot of insomnia this year, so my wrap-up was a lot of ambient jazz and experimental music. It looked very sleepy. My review was, you were sleepy.
2021, man. Oh, Dario, where did yours must be interesting. Where did you get to?
Hey, I'm not going to lie. My wrap-up was my own songs. I was just trying to get my numbers up.
I like it. All right, so let's kick off. The main sort of purpose of the panel is to get at first best album of the year. Andrea, what's your pick for 2021?
My pick for album of the year of 2021 is Mustafa's When Smoke Rises.
Don't grease your air forces, just stay inside tonight. You know what's happening outside. You say it's okay, but you touch your chain. Like if they take it, I won't see you for a while. And I'll tell you how I feel in case it's the last.
All right, so what did you like so much about this album?
I mean, he opens his mouth and I both swoon and cry at the same time. Like, his voice is exquisite. He's a songwriting genius. He is, you know, historically a poet, and he's bringing perspectives to folk music that have been really historically repressed and oppressed. And I love what he does.
All right, so that's Mustafa with Air Forces. Melissa, what's your top album for the year?
My top album of 2021 is Afrik Victim by Modu Mokhtar.
That guitar is so good.
All right, so what is it about that? It's so rich, it's so genuine and unique. What is it about that album that makes it the album of the year for you?
Yeah, I mean, I think on this record, you just have this profoundly talented player who pushes his instrument to a new limit. I mean, with the guitar, he's telling stories that are intimate and personal. You know, there is this through line where he really unravels the legacy of French colonization in Niger, and does it by trapping you into this really rich, warm, psychedelic groove. I mean, I dare anybody to listen to this record and not get on their feet. And in moments when I've been able to dance to this album by myself or in the company of others, it has felt like a moment of healing, a moment of triumph, a moment of resilience.
It really does bring it alive. So, Dario, you're up. Best album 2021?
My best album 2021 goes to Little Sims. She's coming out of London, UK. She put a record out called Sometimes I Might Be Introvert, and my song will be Point and Kill. I do what I want, I do what I like, I know what this, I know fear nobody, nobody.
Proper, no lie, give me strength, let me prosper. Daddy say you want me to be lawyer, be doctor, riff raff, kiddy gun, window shopper. Oh yeah, fine boy, take away auntie, bougie, akile, oh I fancy when I see it.
That's amazing, and I just love it. What is it that you love about that album so much?
You know, it's funny, it reminds me of home. I come from Guyana. I was born in Guyana, which is nowhere near where she comes from. She's from Nigeria. But the same mentality, you know, you're growing up in a whole other metropolis, but you're thinking about home, you're touching on home, your songs are about home where you don't even live. And to add to the title, Sometimes I Might Be Introvert, it's also her working on her being an introvert, but also being a public figure.
It's an interesting year, you know, in that I feel like a lot of artists put out a lot of music this year, but I also feel like I discovered a whole bunch of oldies that I sort of went back down a bunch of old rabbit holes. So I'll ask you guys, what was your favorite new discovery this year? Melissa, let's start with you.
Yeah, I mean, I am deeply devoted to NTS Radio. I feel like for most of 2021, it's been playing in the background. And this might have been like midway through the year. The song by the Jones Girls came on. You're gonna make me love somebody else. If you keep on treating me the way you do. And it, you know, they're a trio from Detroit. They're making music in the mid-70s. And didn't have a lot of independent success, even though they were backup singers for Aretha Franklin and Teddy Pendergrass. But I came across the song, and it just squirmed under my skin. It's like a perfect soul song. It's bold and brave, but narratively, it's somehow like a very desperate plea and a thinly veiled threat to a lover. And I think...
and I think that's my favorite combination.
Somebody.
That's so good. Okay, that's the Jones Girls with You're Gonna Make Me Love Somebody Else. Oh, Dario, let's go with you. What was your favorite discovery this year?
Well, my favorite discovery, I'm realizing I didn't really discover him this year. I've always known of him, but he's definitely come out this year. His name is James Bailey. He's coming out of Toronto.
Yay!
And he's been a backup singer for years. He's always lifted everyone else's song up. He's sang for July Talk, US Girls, Zari, the list goes on. And this year finally was the coming out party of James Bailey. He put out his own record called A Story. I'll play you a song called On My Mind.
What have we done? What have we done to lose our way? What have we done to fall alive? For one of you will hurt falling past your eyes. Only one.
It's amazing to hear because it's him striking out on his own, which is kind of in its own way a 2021 story, isn't it, Dario?
Yeah, he's realizing time is now for me to be me. You know, he's feeling those feels more than any other time.
For sure. Okay, Andrea, your favorite new discovery of 2021?
Well, my new discovery was like basically a love letter to my teenage self. It was Olivia Rodrigo and Driver's License.
Got my driver's license last week, just like we always talked about. Cause you were so excited for me to finally drive up to your house. But today I drove through the suburbs, crying cause you weren't around.
What a freaking delight. If you were a huge fan of Jagged Little Pill in 1995, as I was, this is absolutely a continuation of that journey, or a return to that journey. It sounds like she made it in like the front seat of her car, which is also very exciting since it is called Driver's License. It's perfect. It's a perfect storm of like epic first heartbreak, bittersweet memories, loneliness and frustration, and then that creep of anger, both at yourself and at the person who dumped you.
This is Olivia Rodrigo with Driver's License.
And I just can't imagine how you could be so okay now that I'm gone. Guess you didn't mean what you wrote in that song about me. Cause you said forever, now I drive alone past your street.
So here's what I love about that song, if I may, is that literally every time I listen to it, I took something new away from it. I wonder, to what extent is that a tribute to what 2021 did? Is it made me sort of hunker down and listen better and listen more clearly? It was a strange year. I've wondered about whether we're better listeners, appreciating music for longer right now.
I think so. And I think that when I remember a lot of the records or songs that really gripped me this year, it's like I needed to listen to it like it was an IV drip. I felt like I needed it, and I would listen again and again and again, which was a new experience for me.
Okay, so there's been a ton of new releases this year from top 40 artists. Let's do a quick lightning round here with some of your favorites. Melissa, you first. Which top 40 artists do you think really nailed it this year?
It has to be Range Brothers by Kendrick Lamar and Baby Keem.
Okay, just say you're not ready. Okay, okay, coming in heavy. Okay, they ain't in shape, I'm petty.
I think like for the last 15 years, Kendrick Lamar has had to be the political voice of reason for a generation. And on this record, he is playful, he's silly, he's with his cousin. I think you see him now finally having the creative license to be his most authentic self, or at least the version he wants to be right now.
All right, Andrea, your turn. What's your top 40's favorite for the year?
My top 40 favorite of the year, I think, is Taylor Swift's All Too Well 10-minute version. What I like is the new long version because it gets into the actual meat and bones of Taylor looking back.
And there we are again when nobody had to know. You kept me like a secret, but I kept you like
devastating.
That's some good.
Devastating. Right. Like, that's the moment that I think this song really nails it.
All right, Dario, to you. Who's your favorite top 40 artist of 2021?
Well, to be honest, I just couldn't escape this song, but I didn't mind being trapped by this song. It's Silk Sonic, otherwise known as Anderson .Paak and Bruno Mars together. They put out this single called Leave the Door Open, and I still belt along to this when I hear it. So if you're trying to lay in peace, oh, I'ma leave the door
open. It's so good. What is it for you that makes it nailed so?
Well, first of all, they just robbed Motown blind, but good. Like, you know, good on you guys for doing that. And secondly, you can tell just from listening to it, they had so much fun making these songs.
Mm-hmm,
they could just, mm-hmm. And on top of that, they have a sense of humor. They're not taking life too seriously, and they also encourage you to not take life too seriously. And it was good timing for all of that.
Now that we're through 2021, what are you looking forward to for the music world in 2022? Dario, you go first.
I grew up in Winnipeg, Manitoba, man. I am Winnipeg, Manitoba, a.k.a. Winterpeg, man. It's cold out. We were rock kids. I am looking forward to a lot more rock releases.
Melissa, what's on your list?
I feel like 2022 will be the first year where you can maybe improvise and gather and just play. And I feel like we have a really incredible and spectacular group of releases on the horizon as a result of that.
Yeah, it feels like there's so much pent up out there that's just getting ready to unleash upon us. Andrea, what's made your list?
I mean, I think Full On Catharsis is ahead with Tanya Tagaq's new album, Tongues. The first single, Colonizer, is out, and I love it so much. As a settler, I want to think about my relationship to Canada, so-called Canada, the Canadian music scene, and I love what Tanya is sort of the invitation she's laying out with Tongues and Colonizer.
Amazing. Well, listen, all of you guys, this has been so great to catch up and to hear your reviews and your looking forwards. It's this has just been wonderful. So thank the three of you.
Thank you so
much. Thank you. It's great as always.
Thank you for having us.
Andrea Warner is an author and producer at CBC Music. Melissa Vincent is a freelance music writer, editor, and producer. And Odario Williams is the host of CBC's After Dark and a rapper with Grand Analog.
Time, weather, and
Rift from the headlines.
This is Rift from the Headlines, our weekly quiz. We give you three riffs linked by one story in the news. If you guess the story, you could win a Day 6 tote bag. First, here's last week's clue.
Upon her apron string, my cousin has a great cup ring. My cousin has a great cup ring.
Donovan Woods with My Cousin Has a Great Cup Ring, Neil Young and Randy Bachman with Prairie Town, and the Arkells with Tie Cats Are Hummin'. And they were, right up until they hit the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. Andy Grin of Montreal guessed the headline we were looking for. Hamilton Tiger Cats and Winnipeg Blue Bombers face off in the Grey Cup. Congratulations, Andy. A Day 6 tote bag will be on its way to you soon. And now here's this week's clue.
Here comes the sun. Here comes the sun. I say,
just back into it. Burn up in your atmosphere.
What's the story that connects those riffs? Email us your answer. Put riff from the headlines in the subject and send it to day6@cbc.ca. Please include your mailing address because one right answer will be picked at random. The prize, a day 6 tote bag. You can listen back to the clue again anytime at cbc.ca/day6.
Time, weather, and
riff from the headlines.
And that's our show for this week. Day 6 was produced by Lori Allen, Rachel Levy-McLaughlin, Devin Nguyen, and Pedro Sanchez. Our digital producer is Jason Vermesh. Our senior producer is Gord Westmacott. And I'm Peter Armstrong. Thanks for listening to Day 6.
I love seeing Santa.
For more CBC podcasts, go to cbc.ca/podcasts.